Christian moral principles. There are various approaches that Christians take to moral decision-making. For example, your attitude towards abortion, the use of contraception, cohabitation, sexuality, and so on, may be shaped by one of three principles. Catholic Christianity, Protestant Christianity, the law of love. When it comes to moral decision-making, the Catholic and Protestant Church prioritize the following features differently. Church tradition, the Bible, reason, magisterium. In order of priority, the Catholic Church places more of an emphasis on tradition, then the Bible, then magisterium, and then reason. The Protestant Church places more of an emphasis on the Bible, then tradition, then reason. Some Christians, however, place agape, unconditional love, above all. Richard B. Hayes states that a number of factors might affect how a Christian uses the Bible to make a moral decision. For example, some Christians may be selective in the material they use. So, Richard B. Hayes states that Christians should be aware of selectivity and bias. Similarly, Richard Moo states that Christians should be aware of other commandments and passages in the Bible and not blindly apply the rule of love to every moral dilemma. Neil Messer argues that there are other passages in the Bible that can offer guidance. There are role models and historical books that one can seek guidance from. For example, Exodus chapter 20, verse 14 is a commandment that states, "Do not commit adultery," but one can also read a story such as the prophet Hosea and Gomer, or the woman caught in adultery, and seek guidance there. There are two main approaches to the Bible: propositional and non-propositional. The propositional approach is knowing and accepting something as true. For example, the Old Testament has clear rules about foods that can and cannot be eaten. There are also passages about the roles individuals must play in society. A propositional reader would, for example, choose not to eat a camel. A wife would be submissive to her husband and a slave would obey its master. This is factual knowledge, considered to be fixed moral principles. A non-propositional approach would rather delve deeper and see what meaning they can gain from a story and see how it can be applied to their life. The two approaches often go hand in hand. The latter approach is more personal and experiential. Let's look at the life of Jesus. Rather than focus on the specific details, such as choosing 12 apostles, traveling to Nazareth, there being 2 fish and 5 loaves, Judas being given 12 pieces of silver coin, and so on, one could rather see it as a narrative about hope, love, denial, betrayal, relationships, abandonment, suffering, fear, truth. Here is another way to see it. You can either write a profile about yourself on a dating website for somebody to know about you, propositional, and, or you may choose to go out on a date to really get to know and understand each other better, non-propositional. Some Christians see the Bible as the direct word of God, whereas others see it as the interpreted word of God. Sola Scriptura. This is the belief that the Bible has supreme authority in matters of doctrine and practice. The Bible is the literal word of God. The authors had God's breath, ruach, breathed into them, directly, word for word. The Bible, therefore, is the inspired word of God. This is confirmed in the book of Peter and Jeremiah. The Bible is therefore infallible, without error, and timeless. Scripture is self-authenticating. Its meaning presents itself to you. It interprets itself. It offers propositional revelation. If it says God created the world in 6 days, then a literal, or a fundamental Christian, would believe it happened as said. This is the view held by more evangelical Protestant Christians. And now, for some criticisms.
Similar events, recorded in the Bible, are told differently. Take, for example, the account of Jesus praying in the Garden of Gethsemane, Peter's confession at Caesarea Philippi, and Jesus' appearances after his death, these facts appear to contradict each other. The different styles of writing and themes are too many for it to be the direct word of God. Take for instance the theme and style in the Songs of Solomon and then the Book of Revelations. There has to be, to some degree, human authorship. Again, some moral teachings appear to contradict each other. Take for instance, Leviticus stating the foods that can and cannot be eaten, and Jesus' discussion with the Pharisees in Mark 7, declaring all foods clean. The Old Testament laws on adultery, and Jesus' teachings on adultery differ. Lastly, some of the facts do not match modern scientific knowledge. For example, the creation story, the plagues in Egypt, Jesus' resurrection.
For some Christians, the Bible requires interpreting. It does not have to be taken literally. God inspired different authors who wrote in their own words and style. The Bible must read in context. At the time it was written, it was meant for a particular audience, such as St. Paul's letters and teachings. Some parts of the Bible are more appropriate for the past than the present. For example, teachings of gender roles, women in the church and family can be seen as dated.
And now, for some criticisms. Interpreting the Bible can lead to disagreements and disunity. Take for instance the ordination of Bishop Libby Lane in the Church of England and the views held by Reverend Paul Williamson, also from the Church of England. Interpretation can also lead to cherry-picking, selectivity, so as to put forward a particular, and often narrow point of view. Views on homosexuality tend to be strong, yet cohabitation is ignored and Jesus' teaching on condemnation, ye without sin, cast the first stone. It is difficult to know which stories are meant to be taken literally and which are to be taken metaphorically, such as Jesus calming the storm or the feeding of the 5,000. It is also difficult to know which stories were meant specifically for biblical times and those stories which still apply today, such as the importance of prayer. Can you remember what the Catholic and Protestant Church place in order of importance? Catholics believe that the Bible grew out of the church, as it was the early church, the people, that decided on the books that would make it into the Bible. The Bible, as Richard Hayes and William Spone put it, cannot be read in isolation to the church. Alan Verhey writes that the Bible contains different books and traditions, addressed to a particular community in a specific cultural and social context. Therefore, sola scriptura is flawed. The Protestant Church hold that the Church grew out of the Bible, therefore the Bible is the principal source of authority. The Catholic Church refer to church tradition as sacred tradition. Tradition has priority over the Bible, although the two are linked as declared in the Second Vatican Council. Tradition is sacred because it stems back to oral tradition. That is, the words Jesus spoke to his disciples, including Peter, the first pope, linking to the apostolic succession. Jesus therefore reveals himself through sacred tradition. Catholics believe that the Holy Spirit works in this way. Sacred tradition is summarized in the Catechism of the Catholic Church. The Protestant Church, in particular, the Anglican Church, hold that past and present traditions are of equal importance. The Bible started tradition and was interpreted by tradition. Therefore, moral decision-making needs both the Bible and tradition. For example, although Paul's letters state that women should not be in the priesthood, the Anglican Church accepts women into the priesthood today. The Anglican Church tends to adapt its teachings and practices to fit in with the modern world because church tradition is seen as how the community worships and prays using Scripture. Magisterium. Magisterium is the teaching authority of the Roman Catholic Church, especially as exercised by the Pope. The Catholic Church believes that, It is authority to make decisions on moral matters that affect the Christian community, from matters of war to family or education. This does not replace individual conscience. Vatican documents such as Lumen Gentium, De Verbum, Familiaris Consortio and the Catechism of the Catholic Church express some of these teachings. For the Catholic Church, a Christian can access God's revelation through the use of reason. One can know what to do, as Thomas Aquinas says, through applying reason, which is given to every individual by God. This must be used, alongside tradition and the Bible. The Catholic Church has reasoned that, sometimes, a just war is necessary, although it generally adheres to the preservation of life. The Protestant Church also uses reason alongside the Bible to deal with moral dilemmas. Reason enables a person to make sense of the Bible. Nonconformist Protestants such as the Quakers and Pax Christi are pacifist because they interpret the Bible differently. Protestants may encourage their adherers to use the Bible and prayer to help with moral decision making. Alistair MacIntyre and Richard B. Hayes argue that reason is not objective or neutral, as claimed by philosophers such as Thomas Aquinas. It rather operates according to culture. Reason, as Hayes states, is culturally influenced. Another principle to look at is the principle of love, agape love. This is the unconditional love Jesus exhibited in his life. Love was at the center of Jesus' teachings. He said, "The second most important law was to love your neighbor as yourself." He concluded by saying, "There is no commandment greater than this." There are many scriptures based on love, for example, 1 Corinthians 13 and 1 John chapter 4, verse 8. Rudolf Bultmann pointed out that Christians are to forgive wrongs and not focus solely on laws and judgments. This challenges Bible-based Christians who condemn wrong. Paul Tillich suggested that Christians should abide by justice, love and wisdom. He criticized fixed rules. This inspired Joseph Fletcher's Situation Ethics. Pope Francis recently visited this philosophy and showed support. He said, "It is not helpful to impose rules by sheer authority." This contrasts with Pope Pius, who thought that situation ethics was too individualistic and subjective. Reinhold Niebuhr wrote, "The ultimate law of life is love." As stated previously, Richard Moo argues that just because there is a law of love, it does not override other commandments. Some keywords you may wish to include in an essay: propositional, non-propositional, Bible, scripture, church tradition, sacred tradition, agape love, reason, fideism, moral decision making, deontological, natural moral law, situation ethics, sola scriptura, prima scriptura, literal, interpretation, magisterium, authority, Catholic Church, Protestant Church, Quakers, apostolic succession, Pope, beatitudes, commandments, amanuensis, infallible, inerrancy of scripture, church community, just war theory, pacifism, Holy Spirit, objective, cultural, Martin Luther, Reformation, legalism. Some key thinkers and philosophers you may wish to include: Richard B. Hayes, Richard Moo, Neil Messer, William Spohn, Alan Vahey, Alistair MacIntyre, Reinhold Niebuhr, Rudolf Bultmann, Paul Tillich, Philip Turner on the discussion of tradition, Rosemary Radford Ruther on discussion about women in the Bible and tradition.